Good morning. We'll be starting in just a couple of minutes. We're just letting people join, so we'll be with you shortly. All in all, we'll be starting in just a couple of minutes. We're just waiting for everyone to join the call. Thank you. Good morning, and thank you all for joining the insurance tax update today. I'm Ian Woodruff, one of the partners in Grant Thornton's financial services tax team, and I'm pleased to be your host this morning for the latest instalment in our series of tax events for the financial services sector. Just a couple of logistical and housekeeping points to highlight before we kick off. So on the right-hand side of your screen, you should be able to view your control panels, and this is where you'll have the ability to ask questions of our speakers. So please feel free to tap those in, and we'll try and pick those up as we get to the end of the session. Please note that the webinar is being recorded, and we will distribute this to those that have registered after the event. And apologies in advance for any unexpected interruptions. We're recording this from various places, and there may be disruptions outside our control, but hopefully we won't have any of those today. So we've got quite a lot of ground to cover this morning, so let's make a start. So in the session this morning, we're going to look at four specific areas of tax and consider what insurance businesses should be thinking to address these issues and to take advantage of the opportunities that they present. So first up, I'm pleased to introduce Kevin Martin. He's one of the newest and shiniest partners at GT, and he leads our financial services indirect tax practice. And he'll be presenting with Cliff Mensforth, a director in that team. And they're going to take us through a number of current VAT and IPT issues facing the sector. Following up will be Mo Mogra, who's going to provide an update on the R&D tax regime and the challenges and opportunities that are presented by HMRC's new digital process for submitting R&D claims, and he'll also look at the extensions to qualifying expenditure from 1 April 23 related to data and cloud computing costs and pure mathematics. No tax webinar would be complete without a brief update on OECD's global minimum tax proposals, and John's going to walk us through those and discuss what businesses need to be considering as we approach the introduction of those rules. And then finally, Martin Killer will provide an update on withholding tax reclaim opportunities and what we're seeing from overseas tax authorities. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Kevin. Thanks.
Thanks, Ian. It's been a long time since I've been called shiny, but thank you for that. So good morning, everyone. We just wanted to run you through some of the hot topics in insurance VAT. So I'm going to start by doing that this morning. And I'm also joined by Cliff Mensforth, who's going to give us a bit of an update on German IPT. So I'll pass to Cliff in a little while. But if you want to ask questions of either of us in the chat, please feel free to do so. Okay, so I'll start off with one of the favourite subjects is in partial exemption and VAT, and that is partial exemption special methods. So we are really seeing an uptick in, first of all, inquiries in relation to partial exemption special methods from HMRC. So there's a hot topic there around how is your method working? How are you allocating your costs? Are you sure it's fit for purpose? And is it fair and reasonable? So there's been a number of inquiries I've seen across my client base. But really, one of the biggest concerns, I guess, for partially exempt businesses at the moment is the responsiveness and ability to get PESM approved. So we're really struggling right now across the board to get those through. I think that there's a number of reasons that are really leading to that, but I think it's a lack of resource in HMRC. So we're struggling to get that technical expertise to be able to understand the business's PESM, why it's the right PESM, and then ultimately get that approved. On average, it's between 2 to 4 years at the moment to get a PESM approved. So I would stress, if you are thinking about updating your PESM, you have had a change in business to do that, that you look to do that as soon as possible. The other area that we're seeing an increased focus on is making tax digital and audits of making tax digital. So I just assisted a client recently with the first making tax digital audit that was conducted by the use of the API, the application process interface, so that piece of technology that everyone must use now to submit their VAT return. You'll remember that when the making tax digital rules came out, HMRC said that they would look to use that API link to deal with businesses much more regularly in relation to audits. So I've experienced my first one. It does tend to be those businesses that are less complex. So the really complex partial exempt businesses are going to struggle to be able to provide the data via the link. So this particular client of mine was using a sort of off the shelf piece of software, which was used for their business, and that was relatively straightforward. So I think we are seeing an uptick in those MTD reviews and audits. So just that's also a topic that we're conscious of and seeing a lot of in the market. There's a continued focus on branch registrations. HMRC are making inquiries in relation to branch registrations. We're seeing difficulties still in getting registrations. So for those of you who are close to VAT and were around during Brexit, you remember that there was HMRC working groups. And during those working groups, there was a big commitment to how they would respond to businesses. And there was a number of scenarios that were set out in relation to how business would get their branch registered. And HMRC set out, as I say, a number of those areas that they would accept those registrations. What we've seen is a disconnect between policy and the front line of dealing with those registrations. So we're often seeing registrations being rejected, even though they're in line with what HMRC set out in those working groups. So that continues to be an area that's challenging for clients who are trying to service their European market via the UK branch. And so I think that will continue to kind of gather pace. I think people should be mindful of it. And if you do have a branch registration, which is supporting HO in Europe, that's a particular area where I think you need to be cognizant that HMRC might challenge the validity of that branch registration. The next topic that we're seeing a bit of focus on is notification of uncertain tax treatment. So this came in April 2020. And for VAT, what this really meant is where you had an uncertain tax treatment of 5 million or more, and you had a turnover of 200 million or a balance sheet of greater than a billion, I believe it was, that you would need to notify HMRC that you had some doubts regarding that treatment. There are certain scenarios you can get exemptions, but we have seen again HMRC inquiring as to whether businesses have given that consideration. So those are probably the key areas in terms of where we're seeing a lot of activity from HMRC in particular at the moment. I then wanted to go on to do a couple of case law updates, but I think the one that I'd like to cover the most, so we're recording the session so you can take a look back, we've kept some of the detail in there, but really the one I wanted to focus on most was Stay Sure, because that was a really interesting case and one that is really helpful for businesses that use technology to help deliver their services. And in particular, this case was for an insurance broker that was using technology, outsourced technology to help support its business. And if we could go to the next slide, please. So we've got here a brief history of the insurance intermediary legislation. So for those who are familiar with VAT, in broad sense, if you've got an intermediary that's introducing insurance or is acting in an intermediary capacity in relation to the handling of claims or policy administration, that type of activity or any fees that are generated in relation to that activity generally benefit from VAT exemption. However, where HMRC seem to be getting caught up at the moment in terms of a challenging the validity of exemptions is in particular where there is a piece of technology that is performing that service. And so we saw this with the BlackRock Aladdin case, which you know, those who are familiar again with VAT will be aware that was an investment management case where HMRC challenged the VAT treatment of the management of special investment funds. They actually won that case, went all the way to the CJU, but they won the case really for the wrong reasons. Principally, the outcome of that case, really what we should take from it is just because it's technology delivering a service doesn't mean it can't benefit from exemption. However, HMRC in the Stayshore case, which was 2022, challenged the validity of technology delivering what might otherwise be done by humans. And so in this particular case, we had Stayshore was a UK broker. It had outsourced the running of its website and its pricing platforms offshore. The offshore business ran the platform, the insurance platform, the website, and all that kind of stuff. I owned the IP for that. So an insured would go on to the potential insured would go on to the website, the platform, get a price, get a quote. And if they wanted to go any further, the details would be passed and the pricing that had been given would be passed into a UK broker to go and place that business. HMRC challenged the treatment of the charge in from offshore into the UK. So Stayshore had been treating that as exempt in the UK and said, you know, this is an insurance intermediary service, it benefits from exemption. HMRC said, no, we disagree. We think you should be reverse charging this and accounting the VAT on that service in the UK. And they went to the first tier tribunal on that basis. HMRC's argument was principally that it was an administrative type service and that the consumer wasn't aware. They were dealing with a different business, the offshore business, and therefore it couldn't benefit from exemption. What's really interesting about that is that's not really a test that's ever been put forward, in particular for insurance intermediary exemption. That is always being functionally what is happening. If you know, if you think about a claims handler, for example, they tend to think they're phoning, you know, the insurer tends to think they're phoning the insurer, and it's the insurer dealing with that claim. Well, often it's an outsourced claims handler, but they don't announce that, and the consumer doesn't know that. So it could have been, you know, had HMRC on one of these on those grounds that they challenged on, it could have been quite a big loss for the insurance sector. But thankfully, the court dismissed it quite quickly. The tribunal dismissed it quite quickly and said, no, actually, we disagree. It's clear that this is an insurance intermediary service. The outsource function, it does not matter what the consumer knows. What matters really is actually what they're doing, and what they're clearly doing is getting insured and introducing them through the chain to an insurer with the idea of placing an insurance policy. So that was a really important case, and I just wanted to spend a bit of time on it. There are a couple of slides in here that will talk about some other developments, but as I say, we're limited in time, and I really wanted to make sure that I covered those off before passing to my colleague Cliff, who will talk to you about the IPT developments. Cliff, over to you.
Thanks, Kevin, and good morning, everyone. I think if I look at what you've covered, Kevin, on VAT, there's a mix of, I'd say, compliance focused and obligations, and also some optimizations and opportunities as well. And I think that's what we're seeing in on the insurance premium tax side as well. I think that's why the premium taxes are important, as in not to be an unnecessary cost within the supply chain. So in the UK, you have two premium tax rates, 12%, 20%, and also to make sure that, as I alluded to, compliance obligations are met. And as an example of that, there's been a development in Germany. So a key requirement is, of course, who declares and which party declares the insurance premium tax due. In Germany, as a basic position, if you have a non-EEA insurer, it's the policyholder that declares the tax due. Whereas for Lloyd's syndicates, so this is who this update is aimed at, because of the Lloyd's general representative in Germany, it's been Lloyd's that have taken responsibility and fulfilled this obligation. But because of business changes and because the Lloyd's branch is leaving Germany, in that case, for Lloyd's syndicates, the responsibility for premium tax as a basic position will shift to the policyholders, the insured parties. And of course, that's important to know both commercially and from a compliance perspective. And I think, again, that reflects what we're seeing and the developments that are ongoing. And of course, if you would have any specific questions, both on this general point, managing IPT and optimising it more generally, we'd be delighted to help.
Thanks, Cliff. And I think that's a general theme that we're seeing, isn't it? Just around tax authorities wanting to be able to deal with VAT and IPT with a business that's in country. It's a general shift. It's much harder to implement to implement law on a business that's not established in your country as opposed to one that is. And I think, we've seen that with carousel fraud for computer chips, microchips, that kind of thing. Tax authorities are really looking now to shift where possible liability to counter up the tax on the business that's established in their country, because it's much easier to govern than what it would be otherwise if the business wasn't established there. So I think that's a really important update people need to be aware of, particularly for Lloyd businesses, as you say, Cliff. I think that's a common thing we'll see more and more of. Reverse charges is really a developing tool for them to avoid fraud and make sure they're getting the tax out with the consumer. And that, Ian, I think that's over to you. That's VAT and IPT.
Thanks, Kevin. I think Mo's going to pick up the reins now and take us through the new R&D rules.
Perfect, thank you. So, good morning, everyone. Just to kick off with a quick introduction. So, my name is Mohammed Mo. I'm a director within the Innovation Tax Team here at GT. Really pleased to be here today and look forward to obviously sharing with you some of the main changes in the R&D space. It's definitely the biggest that we've seen since the inception of the scheme about 20 years ago, which has brought about, I'd say, some good news, but also has caught out a lot of claimants by surprise. So if we go back to the spring statement last year, where the government set out its intentions to make the UK a science and technology superpower, it set out its aims to sort of increase R&D investment in comparison to its overall GDP. So going from 1.7% up to 2.7% over the next 5 years. So there's four sort of key areas that HMRC have focused on and have carved out, as you can see on the screen. To start with the good, we're seeing headline rate increases for RDEC claimants and the introduction of cloud computing and mathematics as a qualifying cost and activities. However, with the introduction of new qualifying items, it's expected that HMRC would want to see something in return, especially in light of the recent news that we're seeing around the sort of fraudulent activity that's taking place. So with these changes, they look to be tightening up the scheme by increasing the substantiation element and documentation. And they're also looking to carve out overseas R&D as they look to shift the R&D focus from overseas back to the UK. So if we dive into these a little bit deeper, so if we go into the next slide, please. Thank you. So as we can see, gross RDEC rate is increasing, so from 13% to 20%. So that represents a 50% increase, which is the biggest that we've ever seen. It's a fantastic result. So definitely the government sees this. There's massive amounts of reward there for companies who are investing in R&D, particularly RDEC claimants. However, SME super deduction has drastically dropped, such that loss-making companies will now only receive half of what they previously had. So going from 33.3p down to 18.6p for every pound that's invested in R&D. There is a small clause whereby if you're an R&D intensive company, SME, then you can essentially get 27% instead of just 18.6%. But based on our research, it does seem that it's going to be quite difficult for companies to qualify for that, especially particularly where you're in a group situation. If we go into the next slide, please. So this is quite an interesting area. So this is a new qualifying item, which is cloud storage and data computing costs. It's come at a really good time, particularly where companies are investing in upgrading their infrastructure, moving things onto the cloud. we definitely see insurance companies, financial services businesses, and the likes, and technology media, telecoms businesses really benefiting from this qualified cost category. I'd say the key actions to take away from this is HMRC will expect a reasonable apportionment method approach if you're looking to include these costs. So you probably want to start modeling ways that you can start accurately tracking these costs in relation to your R&D effort versus business as usual type activities. I would also say that license payments for data sets will only qualify if the data sets cannot be resold or have a lasting benefit to the business. So you need to be cognizant of the intention before the actual usage. So that's worth bearing in mind. The government will also be introducing pure maths as part of the R&D regime. So what is that? So pure maths is essentially, it's a branch of mathematics mostly concerned with mathematical concepts such as trigonometry, algebra, and number theory. But what does this actually mean in terms of R&D? So this will definitely expand the areas of qualifying activities as well as costs. So it's going to enhance your claims a lot further. Our view, and based on the research that we've done, looking at comparable regimes, so when we're looking at the Canadian regime, which is a lot more advanced than the UK regime, they actually permit activities and costs in relation to sort of mathematical analysis as a supporting activity. We think that the UK may go even further and allow pure maths entirely as a qualifying R&D activity in its own right. Again, we're still waiting for further details from HMRC as to what that looks like. So hopefully that will be published by the end of summer. Essentially, what does that mean? It's going to bring about new opportunities to optimize your claims further. Roles which were considered to be non-qualifying for R&D, such as actuaries, data scientists, and the like, who are involved in some form of math element, can now be potentially included in the claim. And like I said before, we're seeing financial services businesses, technology businesses, and the like to be the biggest winners from this. So what we recommend is making sure that you've got good sort of data recording systems in place to sort of capture that information. If we go on to the next slide, please. So overseas R&Ds, I remember when this was introduced, it did kick up quite a bit of fuss in the R&D market, particularly where large insurance businesses have got, you know, good overseas presence, that's particularly with the development teams. With the increase in RDEC rate, HMRC are now looking to carve out overseas R&D. With the intention of obviously R&D taking place solely in the UK. The slight good news is that the rules have been pushed back by a further year, so they won't be effective until for accounting periods beginning on or after 1st of April 2024. So essentially, if you have a December year-end accounting period, the first accounting period this will be effective for would be your 1st of January 2025. So you've still got a couple of years left to sort of, you know, plan ahead of the changes. And what we'd recommend is looking at your development teams now and working out, doing sort of cost versus benefit analysis. And that's something that we've been doing quite a lot recently with our clients, helping sort of model the impact. We're having obviously conversations at board level to help sort of support those sort of decisions around whether actually it's still commercially feasible to keep the R&D overseas, or actually it's better to move it back to the UK. There are some exemptions that you can see on the screen. But again, based on our research, we actually think it's going to be quite difficult for companies to qualify for that. So yeah, we'd recommend obviously planning ahead just to avoid any sort of disappointment in that regard. So if you go to the next slide, please. So this is very interesting. So the additional information form. So as mentioned before, HMRC have, you know, they've looked to increase the rates of relief for RDEC claimants. But on one hand, they're giving, but the other hand, they're also taking as well. So with that, they've increased the administration burden. So this additional information form, which will be effective in the next few weeks, is going to change completely in terms of how the R&D process is managed from HMRC side. So it's a digital process, and it requires a lot more granular information. It's quite prescriptive, as you can see on the screen. The main key challenges with this is how companies are going to be essentially presenting their qualifying costs. So HMRC are now expecting to see qualifying costs by project. They also want to see the qualifying costs broken down by indirect activity versus direct activity. And the challenge there for businesses is essentially they just don't have good data recording capture systems in place in order to sort of split that information. So we're working with a lot of businesses right now to help support and devise these sort of data capturing systems and methodologies to sort of make sure that they're optimizing the claim, but also at the same time making sure that they're future proof, such that when it comes to submitting the claim in the future, it's a lot easier and it stands up against HMRC scrutiny. The other aspect of it is the additional requirement to produce technical narratives. So those who are familiar with the sort of typical reports that get submitted to HMRC, which essentially covers off the company's background, the methodology that's used to quantify and qualify the claims, as well as at the end, there's a couple of project descriptions that gives HMRC a flavor as to what the business is doing. Typically, there'd only be two project descriptions, but now what HMRC are expecting is a minimum of three, provided that those three provide a 50% coverage of your qualifying spend, but up to 10. And where this creates a complication is where you have a group, let's say, with a number of subsidiaries. Typically before, you'd only submit one report to HMRC that covers the entire group. But if, for example, you know, that group and its subsidiaries are undertaking a number of projects, potentially going forward, that company or that group will then be required to submit potentially up to 30 or 40, or depending on the number of entities within that group that's claiming technical narratives. So it's quite a huge uplift in terms of what the requirements are. But again, we'd obviously recommend making sure that you've got good engagement from your technical team, such that you're able to capture that technical information that's needed to go into the form. One thing I would sort of flag is with these forms, it's expected that HMRC is going to probably expand the requirements. So it's likely we won't be surprised in a year's time that the format of the form itself will probably change. They may be requesting a bit more additional information. So to try and get ahead of this, we'd recommend making sure that you've got good data recording systems in place. And like I said, you've got good engagement with your technical and finance personnel, just to make sure that you're capturing all this good detail and optimizing your claims as much as possible. If we go into the next slide, please. So pre-notification claims, I suspect this probably wouldn't be relevant for most of the attendees on the call. This is mainly for example, new claimants, where essentially you need to notify HMRC, you know, after 6 months at the end of the accounting period. You don't need to do this if you have made a claim in the last three account periods. Hence why I don't think this would be applicable for most insurance businesses who are already claiming R&D credits. It's mainly for example, startup businesses, or for example, perhaps your development has tailed off such that you've not made an R&D claim in the past three financial years. So it's just something to be aware of. And it's mainly the intention behind this, I think, it's just to sort of help and support HMRC with managing the flow of R&D claims. Definitely there's been a massive increase, I'd say, in the past 5 years. So I think this is sort of a mechanism for them to sort of manage the flow of R&D claims that's coming in. And I think we're towards the end. If we go to the next slide, please. Yeah, so this is interesting. So many people may not be aware, but there was a consultation that happened earlier this year. Essentially, HMRC are looking to sort of combine the two schemes together, the SME and RDEC schemes, and it's looking like it's going to probably convert into the RDEC scheme overall. This brings about some interesting changes. As some people on the call might be aware, there are some complications with, you know, companies claiming under the SME regime. Firstly, you have to obviously make sure that you're an SME for R&D purposes, which requires quite an extensive analysis and also justification to support that view. And also there's certain restrictions in place for SME companies in terms of what they can and cannot claim. Now, if they do combine it together, we're not sure in terms of what the rate of relief will be. We'd hope HMRC would obviously factor in different rates of relief. So depending on how intensive and the size of the actual business itself, they might actually give a more sort of generous rate of relief, similar to what they have right now for sort of high intensive SME businesses. So the consultation has finished, and we're hoping to see the results of that perhaps towards the end of the year. And any changes that gets announced, we'd anticipate that would come perhaps in the next finance bill. But any information that we get from this, we'll be happy to share this with you. So yeah, I'd say probably just look out for more information in that space. If we go on to the next slide, please. So yeah, just a few sort of points and tips in terms of planning ahead. Would recommend obviously definitely looking at your data, you know, identify those costs that could potentially qualify, such as the cloud computing costs and any activities associated with pure mathematics. Look out for your overseas R&D workers. You probably want to start having those conversations now if you're not having them already. Probably want to start modeling the impact, particularly if you've got overseas R&D teams. Look at your documentation. For those who are not aware, I'd say in the past 12 to 18 months, HMRC have definitely ramped up their sort of inquiries into R&D claims, mainly sort of tackling the abuse. And with that, obviously, we're seeing the length of questions from HMRC and the depth of questions expand. And typically, companies who are being held back from receiving the credit are the ones who don't have that good, thorough documentation at hand. So we'd recommend making sure that you've got that good sort of data recording systems that I referred to early on, and obviously having that good engagement with your technical teams. And then final point I just want to sort of shout out is obviously real-time reporting. So this is something which I know businesses are looking into. So for those who are aware, you've got obviously 2 years from the end of your accounting period to make an R&D claim. But within that 2 years, a lot can change. People can move on. You can have, you know, change in systems or your sort of data processes. So it's hard to sort of remember and look back in terms of where your R&D effort is. So we'd obviously recommend trying to move to a real-time reporting basis. And we've got some great tools here that help sort of, you know, digitalize that process. So if you're ever interested in seeing what we're able to do and how we can help, more than happy to sort of do a demonstration, you know, do reach out to myself or Ian after the call, and we're more than happy to have that chat and showcase what we have here. And I think that brings me to an end. So I'll happily pass it over to my colleague, John, who'll be talking about global minimum tax.
Thanks very much, Mo. As I should say, we will have questions at the end, but if you do have any questions that you know already for Mo, or indeed for Kevin or Cliff, do please put them in the chat and we'll answer those at the end. As Ian noted at the start, it'd probably be remiss of any corporate tax session these days not to make at least some reference to the global minimum tax. I'm very conscious that different groups are at different levels of their preparation. Some have needed to and looked into them in great detail and already set up in getting sort of resources together, working out how they need to get their figures and what their result will be. Others, which are medium sized, smaller size, but within scope entities, will be at a different level of their development. And indeed, I know some haven't even started. I've got a meeting out this afternoon with a client who hasn't really thought about global minimum tax yet. Time for them to catch up. But given that this became law yesterday when the Finance Number 2 Act was granted royal assent, you know, it is alive, it is coming. And if we can move to the next slide, I'll say because different groups at different levels, I will give a sort of general overview and make some general pointers. First, it does apply where consolidated revenues are 750 million euros a year or more. And in fact, you look back 4 years, and if at least two of those years you're in excess of those, then you're within the scope of the global minimum tax. So clearly the first thing to do is to work out with your in scope, but also if you're not in scope yet, but you're growing, I mean, obviously inflation and price rises as well as a bit of a growth means that if you're slightly below that limit, it may be that you will be above that 750 million euro amount sooner rather than later. Once you work out within your scope, the rules apply on a jurisdiction-by-jurisdiction basis in order to seek that you've got a minimum 15% of tax rate. And the detailed rules, because these rules obviously need to apply to potentially all jurisdictions, identify what taxes we take into account for that minimum 15%. So in the UK, that would include corporation tax, withholding taxes, controlled foreign company charges, diverted profits tax, but to identify what the covered taxes are, how you allocate those taxes to each jurisdiction, as even though it can be that whilst a tax charge is levied by one jurisdiction, it's actually referable to profits earned in another jurisdiction, and also very detailed rules on how to calculate the tax base for these purposes, which typically will differ from the UK tax base, or indeed the actual tax base in any particular jurisdiction. Moving on, where the global minimum tax rule applies, the default rule is that the parent will essentially include a be levied to a top-up tax, which we call the income inclusion rule. The parent jurisdictions or an entity within the parent jurisdiction will be forming a calculation like a CSC charge to bring in top-up tax so that each jurisdiction in which it invests in, it is paying at least 15% tax, say, based on all those calculations I mentioned before, by how you calculate the tax base for these purposes, how you allocate the covered tax. And that income inclusion rule is coming into UK law for periods beginning on or after 31st of December 23. So essentially from 24 onwards. We've got a similar time frame for 24 for most EU jurisdictions. And there are a number of other early movers, such as Japan and Korea out there as well. Other jurisdictions will come in down the line, but the United States isn't one of them. But we are expecting more and more territories to come within the income inclusion rule. I said it's levied at the level of the parent, but really it's the parent. If the parent jurisdiction itself doesn't levy the minimum tax, then you'll look at the intermediate parent's jurisdiction and down. So if your parent companies aren't applying the global minimum tax rules and your subsidiary, then you would still need to look at the global minimum tax and potentially apply the global income inclusion rule in respect of your own subsidiaries. The undertaxed payment rule would kick in where you have a parent jurisdiction that does not apply the global minimum tax. And what it does is works by restricting deductions in order to ensure that at least 15% tax is paid in a particular jurisdiction. The implementation of the under-tax payment rule is delayed, in that it's later than the income inclusion rule. The UK has said it won't come in before 31/12/24, i.e. for 2025, and later in practice. But that's just the earliest date, and it could well be deferred later. And that's typical what we see across many other jurisdictions, that the under-tax payment rule is coming in much later than the income inclusion rule. Along with the global minimum tax rules, what we got in the Finance No. 2 Act 2013, the UK has also adopted a domestic minimum top-up tax. A number of other jurisdictions are doing the same. And that's really to make sure that if somebody's going to be collecting this top-up tax to make sure you're 15%, then it might as well be us being the jurisdiction in which profits are earned. And of course, the UK headline tax charge is 25%. From now, so it may be in a relatively unusual circumstances where the domestic top-up tax would apply in the UK, but it is there and it has been adopted by a number of other jurisdictions. I should say we're still waiting to see what Bermuda does. They've been consulting internally as to what they do with the global minimum tax. I don't think we would necessarily be surprised if they go for an income inclusion rule to get the 15% tax, but not to have a domestic top-up tax, where's the parent jurisdiction, so that Bermudian profits are still effectively at nil. But we're yet to see what's happening to Bermuda. And of course, reinsurance out to Bermuda is going to be a big source of profits which do get subject to the global minimum tax on a global basis. The rules are very, very complicated, and they also come with some reporting requirements, which we're waiting to see exactly what forms need to be filled in. But even where you work out that you're not going to be within the, actually be levied a charge under the income inclusion rule, there will be reporting requirements to prove that is the case. Again, that's a complexity. Now you need to make that information from your subsidiaries, from your branches, you know, whilst it sort of builds on the starting point, the country by country reporting boards, there are far, far more data points, far more information that needs to be reported under the global minimum tax rules than you get under the country by country reporting. We move to my final slide. There are a number of safe harbours and transitional rules. Again, they need to be checked out to see that they apply, but they can make things a bit easier, particularly in the earlier years. But say you can't just assume any apply, you need to check them and obviously properly document where you think you're within safe harbours so that you can protect yourself against penalties. Number of different transitional rules. There's copious OECD guidance, and I could probably have added also copious HMRC guidance. The rules, particularly how they apply to insurance groups, can be complicated. There are quite a few insurance specific points, both in the OECD guidance and in actually UK tax law as well, that may need to be considered. I think we've been fortunate that the work that the ABI in particular has done in trying to make the detailed rules work better for insurers, but it's still not a very perfect system. It's still very data effect intensive, and it's still quite possible that even though you think you're in a low tax jurisdiction, that there can be sort of unexpected charges popping up in the detail once it's worked through. The final point I wish to make is just on accounting, as accounting standards are changing, not least because it would be very, very difficult to try and work out deferred tax balances for global minimum tax. Now, I've not gone into all the detail there, but there are lots of amounts which are potentially carried forward. Also, deferred tax is taken into account in calculating the effective tax rate, but only up to 15% rather than the 25% that you'd normally find under the UK. But under IFRS and UK GAAP, whilst there wouldn't be deferred tax recognised, there are disclosure requirements which you may need to put into your 2023 financial statements. If current tax is payable, then that would obviously would still need to be accounted for, recognised and disclosed. For US GAAP purposes, we expect the global minimum tax charge to be treated as an alternative minimum tax. I say, but there are those key accounting points. So I think the big issue is that this is happening. It's enacted law for the UK. It's been enacted by a number of jurisdictions, or in the process been enacted by a number of jurisdictions already. If you're within the scope, within that 750 million consolidated revenues, then you cannot ignore this. Even if you think you're operating wholly in high tax jurisdictions, now the minimum you need to prove that the charge is zero, but you may find that there are oddities in the rules as well, which give rise to additional complexity. If you are in low tax jurisdictions, and particularly the insurance out to a group of insurer in Bermuda, for example, then certainly the figures many insurance groups are quoting to their board are enormous, sort of 7, 8, 9 digits long. So it is big for the industry. So different people at different places. If you've not thought about it now, you definitely need to think about it. If you need any assistance, or even if it's a second view of a project that you're already undertaking, then do feel free to speak to Ian or me, and we'll be able to assist you on that. And now I'll pass over to Martin, who will speak on operational taxes.
Thank you, John. Thanks. Good morning, everybody. I'm Martin Killer, one of the partners in the financial services tax team. So I'm just going to spend a few minutes just talking through some pertinent issues for the insurance sector in respect to operational tax developments. So if we go to the next slide, please. So the first thing I just want to talk about, particularly timely, I think, in the current environment where everyone's focused on cost reduction and trying to get money back from where they can do. European withholding tax claims have been around for a fair number of years, and I know a number of, particularly on the life insurance side, a number of businesses in the UK and elsewhere have made claims into different European tax authorities to recover tax in excess of what's been suffered, what's been deducted at treaty rates. It's fair to say it's been going on for a long time, partly due to the fact that these claims have taken a while to be assessed by different jurisdictions, and also because of the complexity of the underlying claims as well. So where we're at currently, just to highlight, we've had positive case law in France in the last couple of years involving a large insurance group. And we've also seen more recently, within the last 6 months, a positive case held in the Netherlands, not at Supreme Court level, but certainly a positive decision at one of the lower court levels, which we envisage will go through the Dutch legal system all the way through to Supreme Court level. But fundamentally, they are both positive decisions which allow for both UK and other European-based insurance companies to potentially claim withholding tax back where they meet the comparability standard with an equivalent local insurance company in those markets. So it's worth looking at where you have made, if you have made claims in the past, whether your facts can be aligned to any of the cases held there, and equally whether there's a need to reassess what's been done previously to strengthen the position of any historic claims that have been made. I think in terms of, you know, key themes coming out of where we're seeing in other markets, like, for example, Spain, we see continued tax authority challenges from in terms of life insurance companies that have made claims there, but equally have seen some repayments made over the last few years. The continual focus is around that comparability analysis between a UK or an overseas insurance company and that exists in Spain. And it's important to think about the regulatory consequences and the analysis that sort of works in terms of looking at what's in the regulatory returns, as well as how the tax analysis works both in the UK and domestically. But again, we continue to see success in Spain, and also in places like Italy, where there's not been a lot of developments for a number of years. Case law is developing there as well, and therefore people should continue to monitor where there is potential for new claims to be made, and equally where existing claims have been made, thinking about the fact pattern and making sure, you know, existing claims have been made and are as foolproof as possible. Because when tax authorities start to look at these claims, we know they will look through the paperwork in a lot of detail to understand, you know, the timing of when claims were made, whether tax vouchers were submitted and equivalent local tax documentation provided. So I think now is a good time to reassess. And then in the theme of opportunities there, I think we are seeing, you know, continued activity from a number of life insurance groups that have probably made claims over the last few years where they've not seen a lot of money come back, and are just trying to reassess whether, you know, their strategy for settling or trying to settle these claims is the right one. So whether that be reassessing, you know, the validity of claims made already, assessing whether there's a need to trigger some kind of inquiry or some kind of reaction from local tax authorities just to try and get the claims moving forward in some shape or form. Or whether there's a need or a reason to assess whether or not future claims should be made in certain jurisdictions where little progress has been made in the past. So there's a whole heap of decisions that people are now thinking about to try and reassess their position. And one of the things we talked about at a recent conference actually is the demand for whether or not some of these claims could be potentially sold in the market to a third party for some sort of value to recoup some pounds now. That was something that was thought about a few years ago, but it seems to be there is growing thought around whether or not some of these claims could be monetized more quickly by going down that kind of route as well, which again, any future purchaser would want to do due diligence on the claims as well. So again, having a good review done on what's been done previously and having a good view on that is clearly important for that purpose too. So if you can move to the next slide, please. So here we've got some other very quick topical developments on the operational taxes front, which I know will be of interest to a lot of insurance companies. The first one is the EU FAST proposal. So these are, you know, looking for a common withholding tax framework across the European Union. We've seen announcements by the European Commission over the course of the last few months and more formalised proposals issued within the last few weeks. The idea being there will be some form of common electronic tax residence certificate that will be provided by all European member states to enable potentially a faster reclaim process to exist in those markets where at the moment a longer reclaim process exists. So this is still subject to final agreement across the different European member states, but we're expecting if enacted, this will potentially lead to a quicker a recovery process for those insurance companies that are on the, at least at the end of the chain in terms of beneficial ownership, looking to reclaim European withholding taxes. Still a question on what the UK will do for this. Obviously, we are not subject to the European regulation on the directive, so we're not necessarily going to sign up in full to what the Europeans would want us to. But certainly from a UK standpoint, the benefits of being in the regime clearly would offer benefits to UK life insurance companies that are on the investment chain. The second area is US 1446F withholding, which again has been around for a number of, well, certainly since the start of the year has been more prevalent. So any insurance company that's got investments in US publicly traded partnerships will probably be well aware of the health warnings around holding those investments at the moment. Certainly, we're still seeing challenges around people trying to either offload those investments or seeking to make reclaims of tax that's been suffered since the withholding rules changed on the 1st of January 2023. So again, it's worth looking at any inventories of investments to see whether that problem exists in your portfolio. And finally, looking forwards, we know there are changes to the reporting requirements of the CRS likely to come into effect from 2026. The OECD as an organisation have consulted on those changes, and we would now envisage the UK, amongst other countries, consulting at a more detailed level. So any insurance companies that have reporting obligations currently under the CRS should be looking at those particular reporting changes, which will come in a few years' time, to check whether there will be a need for further outreach to policyholders in order to meet the new reporting requirements, but also in terms of an onboarding perspective to make sure those new requirements are captured going forward where new insurance policies are provided to new customers from when the changes take effect. And just to be clear, that will apply in all countries that have adopted the OECD standard, as well as across the EU, where DAC 8 has already been endorsed by the European Commission. So again, further changes there to bear in mind. It's worth saying all three of these areas were covered in our recent OpTaxes webinar, details of which will be available on the landing page when you receive details of this particular webinar. At that point, I'll hand back to Ian for questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Martin, and thanks to all the speakers this morning. We've got time for a couple of questions. So if anyone's got any sort of burning questions they want to drop into the chat, then please do so, and we'll try and come get to those. In the meantime, Kevin, a question for you. You mentioned the significant delays around agreeing PESMs. I just wondered what groups ought to be doing while they're waiting for those to be agreed, and if there's anything if you've got any tips for them and things they could be doing to sort of expedite that process.
Yeah, that's a great question, and one we get regularly. There are a number of options available to businesses. One of those is you could go ahead and implement the PESM without HMRC's prior approval. The issue you have there is you've got no security or protection in the event they challenge that new methodology that you've applied. So my suggestion would be not to go down that road. However, if you're getting to a point, as many businesses are, where the change in method is so old it's going over the statute of limitations, and you may end up resulting in losing VAT, well, one alternative method is to submit an error correction notice to reclaim that additional VAT before you fall out of time. So that's kind of one solution. In order to get PESMs approved quicker, one trick that I've used, and it worked rather well until recently with a particular case, but it's worth having a go, is to get your original PESM that you've agreed, hopefully if you have it and it's not too old in Word version, and to do a track changes for HMRC. So what they can actually then see is what the original method was as it was agreed to the one that you're now suggesting. And hopefully they can then focus their minds around the minor changes, particularly if they are minor. So that those are some tricks that I would really recommend. Engaging with HMRC is always a really good way to as early as possible. Get charges there are sometimes it's really difficult, particularly for taxpayers who don't have their own assigned officer. So that can be challenging as well. But those are the sort of tips that I would give. There is also just one final one. If your PESM fundamentally isn't changing, and so you're allocating your costs in the same manner as you did before, but you've got a new business activity, the law does allow for you to allow to bring in that new business activity on a use-based basis.
And what that really means is until HMRC approve it, you recover the VAT based on use. But that is only where there is a business activity that wasn't envisaged in the original PESM. So that isn't changing your methodology or allocation of costs and looking at a sort of revamp of your PESM. That is just where you have a new business activity that isn't covered. So that is also an option.
Thanks, Kevin. That's helpful stuff there. Just another question for you, Mo, if I may. You mentioned the new AIF forms. And these will come into play obviously from the 1st of August. Does that mean that sort of preparing R&D reports, the sort of historic reports that we're used to seeing for our clients, is that no longer required, or is that something that groups will still need to do? Oh, you're on mute, Mo.
Apologies. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, gotcha.
Perfect. Yeah, so interesting. We've been asked this question from some of our clients as well. So what HMRC have said is they will still accept reports, which is a bit interesting because the AIF form is a very detailed, very prescriptive, as I mentioned before. But one thing that it doesn't include in the AIF is the actual methodology. So how have the claims been quantified and qualified? So that's why I think in the future, HMRC may adapt the form itself, sort of include that section. But what we'd say is what's mandatory is the form. The report itself, I think, would probably end up becoming redundant just because there's a lot of stuff which is duplicated in the form anyway. So I'd say if you're used to preparing reports, then obviously, you know, do submit them. But obviously what's going to be mandatory is the form. So, yeah.
Brilliant. No, thanks for that, Mo. That's some useful help there. Just one last quick question before we bring it to a close, and that's for you, John, if I may. Just thinking about any particular areas that you want to highlight as areas of complexity for insurance groups.
Well, there's loads of areas of potential complexity. I think the one is the way deferred taxes is dealt with, and it depends on the group as well. For example, you know, Lloyd's entities will automatically have very large deferred tax balances. They're there, but certainly, yeah, it was important to the industry to get deferred tax included in the calculations. But it does add additional complexity in there. There's also a question of when you're investing through funds and whether they're, you know, transparent and what have you, that you need to look at as well. And that very much depends on what your investment portfolio is. But if it is one where you're not, you know, anything sort of more exciting than just investing in bonds and equities. You do need to look at those and the jurisdictions, things like OEICs and the overseas equivalents are based in. Yeah, I mean, those kind of complex, but it's just the sheer volume of the size of the rules and the and that you can only really be sure of the answer once you've done the workings. I mean, we know particularly if there are losses about that, you can get some unexpected answers and could unexpectedly be brought within a charge, even though you normally wouldn't. So yeah, those are some complex areas, but yeah, really it needs to be looked at. If it's looked at now, there's plenty of time still to brief boards and get prepared for when your first filings would be in the middle of 2025. So it'd be middle of 2026 rather for the 2024 period end. But again, it's, you know, the sooner you've checked out whether those areas of complexity affect you, the better.
That's great. Thanks, John. So I think we're reaching our allotted time. So thank you all to all the speakers for their time today, and to all of you for joining us. I hope you found the presentation useful. Over the next few days, you'll receive a copy of the recording and the slides. So please do feel free to share this with colleagues. And if you know, when you get away from the webinar, and if you think you've got questions that you'd like, or there's certain additional bits of information, then please do feel free to reach out to any of the speakers. And lastly, there should be some details up on the screen of other upcoming events. So please do reach out. Well, you can use the QR codes, or please do reach out to fsgevents@uk.gt.com for further details. But we look forward to seeing you again at one of our other events soon. Hope you have a good day, and thanks very much for joining us.